But people joined already, people.
Hello, Dipen, just you start our first slide of speaker and add our viewers.
Okay, yes, sir.
Hello. Hello, Dipen.
Yes, yes, I'm just sharing the screen.
Yes. Hi, all viewers, and good evening. On this weekend, we are discussing case management in ICU setups, and this myself is Dr. Sachin Chandolkar, ISS Secretary, Nanded. I'm conducting these case meets since I become a secretary, and the reason for that is our ISA National is celebrating Platinum Jubilee in this year. With that, our ISA Nanded also celebrating Silver Jubilee year. So I thought, why should not we start case meets every week with well-known speakers from all over the countries and all over the world? So my friends who are the very much the senior or junior, whatever, but in that field, they are expertise. So I'm calling them and asking them to keep a one case meet. And one of the diamond from our MIT, Dr.Madhusudan R. Jaju, is our senior, sir, and he is presenting common medical emergencies and management in ICU setup for anesthesiologist. He himself is an anesthesiologist. His current position is a director, critical care medicine, Sunshine Hospital, Gachibowli, Hyderabad. He's a great achiever, this thing, with accredited teacher in Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine, for IDCCM certificate course, accredited teacher for diplomat in National Board Examination, Critical Care Medicine. Academic achievements are chairperson, COVID-19 committee in care hospital in pandemic, ECMO team lead at care hospital, chairperson, HICC care hospital, chairperson, morbidity meet care hospital, and treasurer, Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine, Hyderabad, chapter 2021 to 2023. He is currently treasurer. Professional experience, he served as 12 year experience in critical care medicine as a team leader, expertise, and independently handling cases on mechanical ventilator, difficult airways, percutaneous tracheostomy, prone ventilation, advanced life support, including ECMO, UVG guided central venous cannulation, PICC lines, arterial lines, dialysis sheets, catheters, intercostal chest tubes, pacemaker, cardiology assistance, bedside UVG screening, lung, heart, DVT, etc. Treated cases as multidisciplinary team post transplant infections, immunocompromised, COVID-19, severe ARDS, fungal infection, post operative sepsis, SLEDD, CRTT. One of the great person we are meeting this weekend. Sir, welcome on our ISA platform, sir, with DigiShield. Dr. Madhusudan Jaju, sir, please start your lectures.
For those kind words, I'll be always happy to help our the colleague, those who are practicing anesthesia and saving their lives in different locations and difficult locations with limited resources. That I'll be happy to share about the common emergencies, what we are doing today. in our day-to-day practice. Now, as Sachin has requested me to talk about emergencies, what we are getting and how to handle them. As an anesthesiologist, we are doing great wonders in the life, not only our personal life, but a lot of patients we are saving at difficult. The most common emergencies we see day in and out at the various different places about the cardiologic emergencies, starting from the initial with the patient are hemodynamic unstable, having various cardiac arrhythmias leading to cardiac arrest, and even the patient having an hypertensive emergencies. I'll be talking because a lot many things are there to talk. I'll be talking for each for 2 to 5 minutes. If anybody is having any doubts, any suggestions, any point of discussion, they can stop me in between and we can have discussion also. Now it's going without saying about the cardiac arrest is important about early recognition and prevention. I think most of the people from being an anesthesia done a training for ACLS and BLS, activation of emergency response team. In the hospital setup, we do and the code blue. If is there or the med team. Is important a lot of implication and importance is given for the high quality of CPR and early defibrillation. Now we thought previously up to this stage is okay, but as the science is advanced, as the critical care is advanced, not only saving the patient from the cardiac arrest is equally important about the post cardiac arrest care is important and see that functional outcomes are good for the patient and patient come back to recovery and go back to their routine life. That is more important. The reason more and more importance is given as you're seeing about the recent updates of the AHA, BLS and ACLS about the addition of chapter is about post cardiac arrest care and the recovery and rehabilitation for the patient. It goes without saying when we start CPR, it is important to give the, most of the people know because my presentation will be not complete without the ACLS. So that just will brush through about the ACLS because some of the colleagues will be the junior, senior and refreshing our knowledge. So that rhythm is shockable, we give the shock and continue the CPR for the patient with injection epinephrine, 1 mg, 3 to 5 minutes. If the rhythm is pulseless electrical activity or asystole, we do CPR for the patient and always check for shockable rhythm is there or not. And in the meantime, we see that the patient recovery of the spontaneous circulation is there. And if the patient recovering the spontaneous circulation, then we continue for the post cardiac arrest care for the patient. Now, that is the basic thing. I think most of the being an anesthesiologist, of the people are aware about the BLS and ACLS. Now, the other common thing we see in day-to-day practice, whether the patient in the operation theater or intensive care unit, about the various arrhythmias. By seeing this arrhythmia, we understand whether the patient having an atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, patient having a sinus tachycardia, SVT, or the patient having a conduction blocks. Now, once we make the conclusion with the patient having an arrhythmias, now why the arrhythmia is happening for the patient? Now, when there is an increased automaticity, accelerated ectopic rhythm, reason for atrial tachycardia, or the patient having a re-entry phenomena causing for atrial flutter or paroxysmal VT, or triggered activity by the multifocal atrial tachycardia, tonsillitis depointis, or from digitalis toxicity. Now, tachyarrhythmias for intensive care unit is important to keep in the mind with the patient having hypoxia, your light plane of anesthesia because of the pain. These are the common things you think about when the patient getting arrhythmias and see to that these things are properly controlled over a period of time. Now, not only the tachyarrhythmias, the patient having a bradycardic arrhythmias. Why the patient having bradycardic arrhythmias? Because of the thing, decreased sinus node automaticity. It may be because of the various drugs we use for the patient or maybe because of the increased vagal tone or the patient having an AV block or sinus node and exit block. Now, these are the common problems we see when the patient has taken various drugs or medications causing a drug toxicity for the patient. The reason, whenever we are seeing tachyarrhythmias or bradycardias, first see what are the common causes are there for the patients about the analgesia, light plane of anesthesia for the patient, hypovolemia, whether we are using vasopressors for the patient and hypovolemic patient, the most common reasons are there. So that common things are first and think about the other things like electrolyte disturbances, whether the patient having an hyperkalemia or hypokalemia, hypercalcemia or hypocalcemia. These are the other things are the important things you have to keep in the mind. And if you treat most of these things are there, because most of the patients, we do a preoperative fitness, cardiac workup, it's still in spite of that getting the problem, think about all these problems. Immediately we do an ABG and we get most of the values of the electrolytes. We understand, we do treatment for the patients. Now, reversible causes of arrhythmias, most first and foremost common about hypovolemia, because patient keep NBM for longer period of time because of the various reasons, because of the busy schedule in the OT, patient having other issues, or the patient on the diuretics, other things, so that are during the operation having a blood loss responsible for hypovolemia. Second most common things for arrhythmia, see about patient having hypoxia is very important. So that always keep a watch about the oxygen saturation is one of the important monitor to monitor in the intensive care unit and the operation theaters. The patient, the keeping for long time on the patient NBM causing an hypoglycemia is also responsible for cardiac arrhythmias. If the patient undergoing some surgery without proper preparation, like the patients of trauma, having a rhabdomyolysis causing a hyperkalemia, or the patient of the burns, or the patient having and the electrolyte disturbances, particularly patients are diabetic, patients are asthmatic, receiving a lot of insulin, lot of nebulizers for the patient is responsible for causing a hypokalemia, or if we are not able to maintain the body temperature, it's more important for the pediatrics and geriatric age group causing an hypothermia, or because of the various reasons, patient getting an acidosis. These are all responsible for the various cardiac arrhythmias. And we know very well how to know and what is the treatment is there. Obviously, for hypovolemia, correction of the volume, hypoxia, see the proper ventilator settings, see about the endotracheal tube, auscultate the lung, see about the proper supply of the oxygen from the cylinder or from the center thing. Always check the sugars. Don't underestimate for the patient for giving the sugars. By giving a 5% dextrose, things are not going to correct. Hyperkalemia, we give the things for the immediately injection calcium gluconate or glucose insulin drip or being given beta agonist. If the patient having hypokalemia, we do try to correction of the potassium. And if the patient having a temperature problem, we try to correct the temperature, either external or internal warming because of the various reasons. Now, not to forget about the various toxicologies, because these are not common things we are dealing in the operation theater. If the patient comes with unknown poisoning, keep in the mind because of the various toxins are there for the patient, responsible for the various cardiac arrhythmias. Think about the patient getting an ACS, patient having an PTE, or patient having a pericardiac tamponade, or the patient having a trauma, all are responsible for causing cardiac arrhythmias, and see what is the underlying cause. Once you know the underlying cause, try to correct it, and automatically arrhythmias will get corrected. Then before jumping on the various antiarrhythmic medications, whether we are giving beta blockers, whether we are giving a verapamil, whether we are giving a digitalis, whether we are giving an amiodarone, so on and so forth. Now, next common thing in the continuation of the cardiac thing about the shock. Now, the different varieties of shock, what we see about the hypovolemic shock, cardiogenic shock, or obstructive shock. Once we know the shock, which type of shock we are treating is important because treatment is diagonally opposite. If the patient having a cardiogenic shock, there's no point in giving the volume for the patient. And the same way, if the patient having an obstructive shock, only giving a vasopressors are not going to work out. So that whenever seeing the shock, we have to see about the pump, the tank, and the pipes. So that the treatment will differ in cases of hypovolemic shock, we give the fluids. The patient having a cardiogenic shock, we give the inotropes plus diuretics, and the patient having an obstructive shock, we do reversal of obstruction. Now, how to identify? So that the recent which gadget are there using, if the we are working in higher centers and you are using a cardiac output monitor and or the PA catheter, so that we get and various things are there whether the patient by knowing the cardiac output, by knowing the SVR or the pulmonary artery occlusion pressure, we know about what are the changes happening on the cardiac output. If the patient cardiac output will come down in cases of the cardiogenic shock, SVR will be high and pulmonary artery occlusion pressure will be high. The reason we have to say that patient using an inotropes and getting a diuretics so that SVR will become overcome. In cases of hypovolemic shock, the SVR will be low. There's a more role of using an vasopressors. If the patient having a distributed shock, the cardiac output will be high because of the hyperdynamic circulation for the patient. And we see the SVR and pulmonary artery occlusion pressure is low. Now, what we follow particularly in the intensive care unit or in the operation theater, if the patient comes, follow a rush protocol. It's nothing but a rapid ultrasound in the shock and hypotension by checking their pump, the tank, and the pipes. When we tell about the pump, it is important for the cardiac evaluation. When we talk about the tank, it is the volume status evaluation. When we talk about the pipes, it is the vascular system evaluation. Now, this all thing can be done in less than 2 minutes period. How will do 2 minutes period? I just tell you. Now, everybody is using an ultrasound machine. I think everybody has been trained for using ultrasound machine for the various tubes, lines, and catheters. In the same probe, if you are doing, the learning curve is very small for learning the ultrasound. Under observation, if you do 10 ultrasounds and unassisted, you do another 30 ultrasounds, that is sufficient so that your accuracy for diagnosing the problems is more than 80 to 90% is correct. And all this can be done within a two weeks period so that we'll be having an enough confidence about getting the window and making a diagnosis for the patient what the problem is there. Now, when we talk about the cardiac evaluation, determine the presence of perifusion is very important. And we see about the all chambers. We see if you are able to appreciate, see the cardiac
Hello, Dipen. Hello.
Hello.
Dipen, voice and everything is gone.
Sir, ka mute pe sir.
ठीक है sir को phone करेंगे.
Sir mute pe.
Okay, you are able to hear now? You are able to hear?
Yes, sir. You are mute. For a while, you are mute. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. We'll move on.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. From here only. Yes.
Okay. So that I just talking about the 2D echo probe, we get it and we can see the pericardial effusion. It is very easy, it is not difficult. The same way you're doing an eyeballing, it is not necessary to do an all the measurements about all things about how much about the E wave, how much of the I wave, how is the fractional shortening. All these things are not necessary in cases of emergency. It's important to do an eyeballing and see about the left ventricular contractility, whether the patient having a moderate, severe, or mild contractility. By seeing if the kissing ventricles are there for the patient, maybe a hypovolemia is there for the patient, or the hardly the contractile is not there. When we are seeing about the LV, see about the apical wall, see about the medial wall, and see about the lateral wall, so that we'll understand where the patient having the problem, which anatomical territory is having the problem. At the same time, we can check about the RV function also. Now, once we are done about the pump, we do the evaluation of the tank by seeing the tank fullness. How we see the tank fullness? By checking IBC. Okay, then we do a leakiness by doing the fast examination, a tank overload, effusion and pulmonary edema, and tank compromise by assessment of the pneumothorax. Now, how all things we do? Just putting an ultrasound probe in the epigastric region, 2 centimeter medial to the midline and direct to the RA, so that you should be able to see the IVG along with the hepatic vents, and we should be able to see the cardiac contractility. Now, whether the IVC is dilated or IVC is collapsing or the IVC is a normal. Now, by seeing an IVC, just put an M mode on the IVC. By putting the M mode, we can do calculations about the disability index, the collapsibility index, or a variability index. On that basis, we can decide about the patient that requires the fluids or not. It is having some fallacies for the patients, if the patient having cardiac issues and problems, but that you have to keep in the mind. Each and every investigation has to be interpreted along with the patient condition. Now, when we talk about the tank leakiness by doing a fast examination, once you put the probe in the right upper quadrant, we see about the right costal diaphragmatic recess and hepatorenal space, that any collection is there here or here, we know what is the problem is there for the patient. If the patient comes to the blunt trauma, if they're having patient hemoperitoneum, it requires a different things so that we can do an hypotensive resuscitation for them. By putting the probe in the left upper quadrant, we see in the left costal diaphragmatic recess, we can see here the diaphragm and the part of the spleen. And here we can see this is called as curtain sign, how much the diaphragm it is moving. We can see 3 to 5 centimeter diaphragm has to move, or we can see the splenorenal recess. We can see the spleen and kidney, a splenorenal recess. If you see in the zipoid process, by putting in the zipoid things, we can see how much is there, the 4-chamber view for the patient having diffusion. We put in the pelvic in cases of the male for rectovesical region, and in cases of the female, rectouterine space, and with the anterior thoracic region, see about the lung sliding sign for the patient. Once we see about the tank overload, assessment of the pleural effusion and the pulmonary edema, so that what we do, by put a probe in the lung and see the 2 ribs on the side, it is called as the bat wing sign. Then we can see the wide glistening pleura. We put an M mode on this and see whether having the patient A lines, B lines. Or this is the normal the presentation of the lung when you are putting the probe, the particularly the straight probe. And if the patient from the pleural line, we are seeing the more than 3 rockets coming from here and going down to the image, so that it indicates that patient having a fluid overload. No point in giving more fluid for the patient, even if patient having hypotension. Think about patient having some other problem. If you are seeing the B lines, there's no role for giving the fluids. Maybe using a diuretics or using a vasopressors for the patient. Now, the tank compromise assessment for the pneumothorax. As I told, here we can see the 2 ribs here, the same thing, and we can see the glistening pleura. Once you put on the M mode on the pleura, we can see the normal is called as C-sure sign or is called as barcode sign. If the normal lung is moving with the aeration, we have the C-sure sign. If because of the pneumothorax, if the lung is not moving, it's called as barcode sign. Okay, so that the C-sure sign and the barcode sign is very important. You always make it a point when you are putting central line, the probe that you are putting in the neck, at the same time put the probe on the chest and see. This is the best investigation to rule out the pneumothorax. Even the small amount of air, as low as 2 ml of air, also we are able to identify the ultrasound. That's what we can miss with the routine chest X-ray. The step 3 about the pipes about the vascular system, the same probe what you are putting in the right side, put the probe on the left side and see about the aorta. Okay, normal abdominal aorta, and you do a measurement for the aorta. What is there for the aorta? Normal measurement we see about in between 1.5 to 1.8 or maximum about 1.8 centimeter. But whenever the diameter of aorta is more, think whether the patient having aneurysm or we are seeing the flap, whether the patient having dissection of aorta. So that we understand what the prevention problem lies, so that we cannot increase the BP for the patient and what next measurement has to be done, we decide. Or the pipe may be clogged, maybe because of the clot, it's called as deep venous thrombosis, is called as 2-point compression test, because we know the veins, we are very habituated for putting the central lines in the IJBs. We compress the vein in the same way, the same principle used for the femoral and popliteal vein, and rule out patient not having a DVT. So that patient not having DVT, so that it is an more than 90-95% rules out patient having a DVT. Now, all things putting in the proper perspective is called as false protocol, by ruling out the obstructive shock, ruling out the cardiogenic shock, ruling out the hypovolemic shock, and detecting the distributive shock or septic shock what the patient is suffering. Now, the bedside, the shock evaluation, by seeing the various monitors, what has the patient, we can know what the patient having the problem. The narrow pulse pressure, patient suggests the low cardiac output. Why the low cardiac output? They try to see the clinical condition. Are the patient having a wide pulse pressure with the diastolic hypotension, suggests the high output shock. By seeing an echocardiogram, what we discussed just now, by doing a lung ultrasound, abdominal ultrasound, we get the various inferences, and it has to be corrected, correlated with the patient condition. Now, once we see the shock, the most common thing about seeing an ECG and the various ECG changes. If anybody doubt, any questions are there, we can take the questions in between, because this is quite vast. If any questions are there, I'll be happy to take the questions. If not, we'll proceed.
Okay. Hello, Madhusudan. This is Sushruti here. Good evening.
Hi, good evening, good evening.
Yes, I wanted to ask whether do you do a old school taps after if you see collection or anything like if you are, whether it is hemorrhagic or do you do the taps, blind, this abdominal taps?
No. That is an old type of fashion.
Yeah, that is old school.
Complications and problems. No longer it is done. On that basis, we'll decide the patient having a leak. Leak is there from where the leak. Immediately do an angiography if require an angioembolization for the patient. The previous thought process of every time doing a laparotomy, it is not there now, because they say that the bleed itself act like a tamponade. So they don't remove the tamponade effect. Keep a close watch on the hemodynamics and the hematological parameters for the patient.
Okay.
So that moving to the next common things about people are afraid about the various ECG changes when we do an ECG for the patient, either preoperatively, intraoperatively, or postoperatively. So that don't have fear in the mind about the ECG changes. Try to understand that ECGs are only 27 or 30% are the specific for detecting the MI changes. Otherwise, the ECGs are not comfortable for detecting the MI changes. Now, whenever you see the ST elevation for more than 2 mm in contiguous about the chest leads and for 1 mm in limb leads, that's the main difference you see. Or if the preoperative ECG done and if new onset of LVB is there, think about the patient having cardiac issue, or the patient may be all ECG changes, still the patient having the problem, think about patient having a true posterior MI. These patients normally they have the loose motions, they present with the loose motions in the hospital, and think, don't treat the loose motions because it may be because of the posterior wall MI. So that if you are seeing talking about the STEMI, not about NSTEMI, ECG may be normal. The reason some of the patients, they say that ECG is normal and patient collapsed after going home. The reason I told specificity and sensitivity of ECG is less than 30%. So that don't believe on the ECGs is important. Now, what happened for NSTEMI? We see an T wave inversion or hyperacute T waves, maybe because of the NSTEMI. ST depression or borderline ST elevation, or the patient have tachycardia or bradyarrhythmias. It requires a proper evaluation for the patient is very important. That you have to keep in the mind. Now, once we see about the ECG and all things are there for the patient, is about the STEMI, what the protocol is given. Here, we can see about the patient, the emergency medicine, whether we are to going the PCI-capable center, and once we go to PCI-capable center, what you are going to do. These are the different things they are given. Everybody has to follow this protocol. If the VR center is NABH or recognized with some other things are there, is mandated to follow and keep it. They don't do only on the paperwork, but do it practically. It definitely improves the outcomes of the patient and improves the efficiency of the system and improves the efficiency of whole hospital also. So that the ACL and BLS protocol, they told very clearly, do an emergency chest pain is there, do emergency call, do an ECG, a diagnosis of STEMI, whether the center, we are able to do a PCI or not. If you are able to do PCI, try to reach to the PCI capable center in less than 120 minutes. And once you reach to the PCI, see that wire is crossing across the culprit vessel in less than 90 minutes. If you are not able to reach less than 120 minutes to PCI capable center, we can do it immediately fibrinolysis and should be taking less than 10 minutes. And if the patient is a PCI capable center itself is there and say that patient is doing PCI and should be done in less than 60 minutes. We in our hospital regularly we follow this and see to that if any problem is there, do root cause analysis and find out why the delay is there for the patient. Now, the strategy, what has to be done within the hours and over a period of time, they are given the various recommendations are there. What you told in cases of STEMI, 0 to 10 minutes, we can see here in cases of STEMI, 0 to 10 minutes, we have to finish the ECG monitoring. Grade 1B recommendation is there. If you are not able to go PCI capable, see about fibrinolysis, starting an enoxaparin for the patient, and up to 10 minutes with the loading doses of the aspirin and clopidogrel. Now, the new thing is there for using ticagrelor and prasugrel, depending upon if the PCI capable center is there, if you are immediately planning for PCI, then we can do ticagrelor for the patient about 90 mg twice daily. If not, then we do about, because they found that a lot of patients are developing resistance. We heard about the resistance only for the antibiotics, but they found out the genetic resistance having for clopidogrel aspirin, the reason that patients having MI and they die in spite of giving the treatment for the patient also. Okay, so that this is the repetition of what we told in a schematic representation. The end stem is very important about the clinical setting symptoms of vital signs, about the EC changes what for the patient. Yes, the depression are significant, and they do a drop to elevation, drop elevation at 0 hours and 3 hours, and see what is happening for the patient. If you are observed for the patient almost for 3 hours and we see the ECG is normal, troponin is negative, then we can keep the patient on for observation. We can see here if the patient having a suprasternal pain, intrascapular pain, or in the complete the anterior part of the chest and pain relating to the neck and the hand, it requires for the patient or patient in the shock requiring CPR. The reason in this time, we have to see for the patient having the problem. So that will rule out MI for the patient. And once you rule out, rule out the MI for the patient, it is important to rule whether you're keeping the patient for observation or patient keeping for the further evaluation of treatment. The reason any patient comes with a chest pain, don't send within first 3 to 6 hours, do proper evaluation, then only send the patient. Otherwise, they say that not diagnosed properly and patient collapse after going to the home. So that rapid ruling out about the algorithm about what to do and what to do, the same repetition what we're doing in a schematic presentation, because we have limitations of the time, will not repeat again. So that what the guidelines say is that continuous rhythm monitoring is recommended until the diagnosis of STEMI has been established or ruled out is very important. The reason these patients are kept observation in the emergency room or in the ICU. It is recommended to admit STEMI patients to the monitored unit. About the ECG and other monitoring has to be done. Rhythm monitoring up to 24 hours or to PCI, which comes first, is recommended in STEMI patients at low risk for the cardiac arrhythmias. Rhythm monitoring, how much requiring for more than 24 hours, and is recommended in NSTEMI because increased risk of cardiac arrhythmia as compared to the STEMI. In the absence of signs and symptoms of ischemia, rhythm monitoring with unstable angina may be considered in patient-selected patients, particularly suspicions of coronary spasm or associated symptoms suggestive of the arrhythmic events. So that if you require more than 24 hours monitoring, if the patients are hemodynamic unstable, ejection fractions less than 40%, failed reperfusion are requiring an additional therapy for the patients. I think I'll give the stop regarding the various cardiac arrhythmias, the STEMI and NSTEMI. Okay. In continuation of that, about the cardiac emergencies is called as an hypertensive emergencies. So that when you tell about hypertensive emergencies, various the terms are there, they become an absolute. Now we are using a hypertensive emergency if the patient having an end organ damage. The patient not having end organ damage is called as urgency. And accidental hypertension is there if the patient not having end papillary edema. That is the main differences in the new definitions of the hypertensive emergencies. Whenever the systolic blood pressure is more than 220 and diastolic more than 120, it comes under the category of hypertensive emergencies. Now, the various causes are there for about the hypertensive emergencies and urgencies. We should rule out one by one and see why is happening for them. Now, whenever the patient having an end organ damage, there are two ways are there. The people will ask the question, when to give an IV medications, when not to give an IV, the oral medications. If the patient having an end organ damage requires an IV medications for rapid control of the blood pressure, if the patients are stable, we can give oral medications admitted in the ward or in the high HDU. If the patient having high blood pressure and regularly monitoring, even we can do an OPPC treatment up to 160 or 170. So that acute myocardial ischemia for the patient hypertensive, the medication of choice about the NTG, the beta blockers and ACE inhibitors. If the patient comes with the pulmonary edema with congestive heart failure, the drug of choice will be the NTG along with the diuretics and the morphine. Try to understand the treatment will be different and reasons are, the obvious reasons are there why you're using this medication. So that every hypertensive patient, try to understand what is the cause is there. On that basis, we have to give medications for the patient. If the patient having an acute aortic dissection, as I told in the previous slide, about acute aortic dissection is important for the rapid control of blood pressure by nitroprusside, beta blockers for the patient. If the patient having a hypertensive encephalopathy or subarachnoid hemorrhage, it inquires for the nitroprusside, labetalol, and the drug of choice will be the nimodipine. The mavotyramine tyramine interaction with acute hypertension, the drug of choice will be phentermine. Okay, I think we need the full stop about the cardiac things. We spoke almost more than 20 or 25 minutes. Now we'll move to the neurological emergencies. If any sir, doubts, any questions are there?
Yes, yes. I think Jaju sir is one question in question box.
Okay.
What is STMI in pregnancy near term?
Okay.
From Dr. Gopal.
Okay, the if STMI in pregnancy and near term, because we know the pregnancy is because of the thrombogenic reasons are there, mostly happens because of the blood clot for the patient is very important. The treatment for the STMI remains the same, near term is there for the patient. Most of the people are afraid for the bleeding and everything is there for the patient because here important for saving the life. Important for the patient, if the PCI capable center is there, go for the urgent PTCA for the patient. Don't bother about for the patient having a radiation exposure because patient in the third term is more important than the first term. Okay, these are the important guidelines in cases of the pregnancy. Preferred choice of treatment is a primary PTCA to the culprit vessel and continue the other medications for the patient if the patient near to the term is there. I think I've given the answer for the question. Any other thing is there? We can take.
I think you should continue.
So that the next the common emergencies will be there about the neurological emergencies, whether the patient having status epilepticus, the patients are the encephalopathy, coma or decreased consciousness, a patient having a raised ICP or patient having stroke, it will be ischemic event or hemorrhagic event. Now, when we talk about the status epilepticus, we see about the various definitions about the status epilepticus. These are the new definitions which came. The patient having a refractory status epilepticus, it means patient is refractory to two anti-epileptic medications. Now we are having a super refractory status epilepticus. It's called as a non-convulsive status epilepticus or super refractory. It means patient having continues to have seizures for more than 24 hours. After the use of even the more than three combination of anti-epileptic medications along with anti-anesthetic therapy, so that status epilepticus recurs on the weaning of anesthesia, or a new onset of refractory status epilepticus, a prolonged period of refractory seizures, is an identifiable cause and maybe a reason of autoimmune encephalitis. These are the new definitions are there. Now the days are gone about saying about whether the patient having epilepsies and all things are there. Okay, so that patient, these new things we have to keep in the mind, according to that treatment protocol has been changed. Now, whenever we talk about the epilepsy or the status is there, always go from the ABC, assess and control of the airway, monitor the vital signs, sometimes patient having a hypothermia or maybe hypothermia, see about the oxygen for the patient and see about the cardiac function, check for the blood sugar is very important. That's the most common missed thing is there, patient having an even hypoglycemia also have the epilepsy and having neuroglycopenic symptoms. If the patient having an the hypoglycemia, always see that patient before giving glucose, always give thiamine for the patient is very important to prevent neurological complications and neuroglycopenic symptoms. If you reverse the things, even if you correct the glucose, patient have the damage, have the Wernicke's encephalopathy, the reason, the sequence is very important. Sequence is there, first give thiamine for the patient, followed by dextrose, if 50% dextrose is available, if not, we give 25 dextrose, 100 ml. If the patient having a status, once you rule out all things are there, take a focus history of clinical examination for the patient, whether the patient has the known history of the seizure, the trauma, and the patient having an infection, the patient having an uremia, the patient having an hepatic disease or a substance abuse, treat accordingly for the patients. And immediately we do for the CBC, electrolytes, ABG for the patient, liver function, renal dysfunction patients, and don't forget about toxicology. That's the most common forgotten things in integrative practice. Lot of poison patients have the seizures, including the organophosphorus, and the we do a serum antiepileptic drug concentration. Even the doses of the drug like levipil or iptoin, if you're giving the high doses of the drug, itself cause the problems. The reason is important for monitoring for the drug levels of the antiepileptic medications also. You can see here down about the time duration, how much the time duration is there. So that the within the minutes and the first 5-10 minutes is important for starting and lorazepam around 0.1 mg per kg. If required, if you are not able to control the seizures, seizures are continuing, give the phenytoin. If fosphenytoin is available, give fosphenytoin. In spite of that, the seizures are continuing for the patient. See to that immediately before loading the phenobarbital for the patient, if you are having available propofol or midazolam, we can start for the patients and load with the phenobarbital for the patient. And subsequently, we can use continuous infusions of the benzodiazepines or propofol. Then you go into the other treatment for the patient. But don't forget about the giving the basic treatment for the patient is important. And what in the previous slide I'll show about the reversible causes, treat the reversible causes for the patient. And keep in the mind about the time duration is very important. Okay. And afterwards, we can use levetiracetam, lacosamide, depending upon focal seizures or generalized seizures for the patient. Okay. This is the thing about the seizures. Next thing about for increased ICP. Increased ICP may be because of primary, the neurological reasons, or because of secondary reasons. Primary reasons because of the traumatic brain injury, because of the brain tumors, because of the ischemic stroke, because of the obstructive hepatocephalus, because of benign intracranial hypertension. All the reasons are there for raising ICP. What are the secondary reasons are there? Maybe because of the hypoxia for the patient, maybe even hypoxic brain injury, hypertension just never seen, the patient having and the hyperparesia or seizures all are responsible for the increased ICP. Obviously, the prognosis will be good for the secondary reasons for raised ICP than the primary reasons for raised ICP for the patient. Now, these are the common reasons we understood for the ICP. Now, the drug of choice for reduced ICP, what we do, if you are having a transcranial Doppler, do with the transcranial Doppler or optic nerve sheath diameter there for the patient, we can do optic nerve sheath diameter. The learning curves are very, very small, or a small period request is not very high five things. With the small attention and knowledge, we can improve your skills about ONSD and transcranial Doppler also. Now, decreased consciousness will be seen about the various reasons, traumatic brain injury, ischemic stroke or the hemorrhagic stroke, hypoxic ischemic injury, the maybe CSVT, malignancy, meningitis for the patient, or patient having a press hypertensive encephalopathy, or the patient having an acute disseminated encephalomyelitis for the patient. All the reasons are there for decreased consciousness for the patients. Now, in continuation of that, the patient may be having the brain abscesses, the brain tumors. Post-COVID, we see a lot of patients having brain abscesses, having fungal infections. Either we treated a lot of patients by doing a brain biopsy, aspergillosis, mucormycosis, the tuberculosis, and the various gram-negative infection for the patients. The brainstem disorders, particularly keep in the mind about the pons and midbrain. Because of the hemorrhage, infarction, tumors, or trauma are quite dangerous. Patient will have suddenly cardiac arrest. The other systemic causes, always not to forget about the various medications what we use for the patients, about the opioids or benzodiazepines, the drugs, about the alcohol, methyl alcohol, ethylene alcohol, amphetamine, and cocaine, or have exposure to the carbon monoxide or heavy metals are responsible for the altered sensorium for the patients. Other metabolic issues about the patient having and electrolyte disturbances, hypernatremia, hypercalcemia, the patient having hepatic failure, warning encephalopathy, or renal failure. So that it is a very broad reason this is there for causing an altered sensorium. We have to find out what are the reasons. And treatment is not for every altered sensorium or epilepsy. For giving an anti-epileptic medications, important to treat the underlying cause. Okay, I think we'll give the full stop here for the neurological emergencies. If any questions or any doubts are there, we can take, we can spend half a minute or a minute. in chat box. I am just checking in the chat box is having one question. I think the same question is there. I given the question for the answer for that. If no other question, we'll move. The next common things we've seen about because all the people are expert about managing the airways, still we face some problems of the airways, respiratory emergencies in the term of airway obstruction because of the various reasons. How we rule out the airway obstruction by doing a blue protocol, the ultrasound, maybe patient having a pneumonia, maybe having community acquired pneumonia or hospital acquired pneumonia, or patient having a status asthmaticus, or patient having acute exacerbation of COPD, or patient having a pulmonary embolism. Now, the airway obstruction, I think most of the people are aware and expert, just for the completion sake, the patient having a trauma or hanging, having an upper airway edema, or patient having a viral infection, epiglottitis or retropharyngeal abscesses, or the patient having an angioedema because of AC inhibitors, or because of the various other reasons, particularly the Wasmol dye we're using for here. We see a lot of patients are doing and having an airway obstruction. Anaphylaxis, because of the Bose inhalation, maybe having a strangulation, maybe because of the large mass, maybe because of the thyroid, maybe because of the trauma, or the following thyroid surgery, or following the intrajugular line, if they're not placement of the line. These are all the reasons are there for the airway obstruction, either internal or causing an outside compression for the airway. What are the neurological causes for causing an airway emergencies? Is because of the patient having intoxication or head injury, patient having a raised ICP causing laryngospasm aspiration, neurological diseases like myasthenia gravis, Guillain-Barré syndrome, and inadequate reversal of the muscle relaxants all are responsible causing an respiratory emergencies. So that not only the respiratory primary reason, because of the central neurological reasons also we face a lot of problems. Now, we'll just go for the blue protocol. The upper and the lower blue points are there. In that, I told about putting the probe on the lung and see the lung sliding. If lung sliding is present, the patient having bill profile is obviously the reason is pulmonary edema. If the patient having an A profile, then do a sequential venous analysis by the DVT screening for the patient, maybe having a pulmonary embolism. If the patient having free vents, do the flaps and think about patient having a pneumonia. If the patient having an NE profile, A, B, or C profile, think about the pneumonia. If the patient having the lung point is there, thinking about pneumothorax. If the patient is not having lung point, then think about the other causes for respiratory emergencies. This is very important. With less than 1 minute, just putting the probe on the lung, we understand what is the cause of respiratory emergency. Is the primary the reason is the lung, or because of the secondary reason is there, we'll have the clear idea. I think it's very important. Everybody should learn about the blue protocol. Now, whenever we see about the oxygenation failure, second point, maybe because of the cardiac pulmonary edema, if we having start an NIV for the patient and start diuretics and NTG. If the patient having pneumonia and ARDS is there, a lot of people are think about putting an NIV, but try to understand that NIV failure is there. Don't hesitate for putting on the patient on ventilator. It should not happen in cardiac arrest and putting in ventilator for the patient. I will tell about the criteria of NIV failure. If putting an NIV, if the requirement of PEEP more than 10, FiO2 more than 0.6, the respiratory rate more than 20 for the patient, and the work of breathing is more, is an indication for putting an invasive ventilation for the patient. And once you put an invasive ventilation, I think you are aware about following an ARDS network protocol. If it's not there, think about the weak mismatch, thinking about the pulmonary embolism for the patient. Okay, then the most common, other common thing about the patient having and the cap, if the patient is not in the ICU, if the patient on OP basis, we just add the beta-lactam plus macrolide, that is a strong recommendation is there. And in the patient in the ICU, we start an IV beta-lactam antibiotics along with the macrolide, if SOS fluoroquinolones. And if the patient having pseudomonas infection, either we use an antisocial antibiotic, either beta-lactams, beta-lactam inhibitors, aminoglycosides for the patient, or the penicillin group of medications, which are effective for the pseudomonas. If the patient is allergic to the penicillin, we use an monobactams, is called as an aztreonam. What are the complications of the cap pneumonia? If it may lead to sepsis, and if you are not taking proper care in early stage, responsible for causing MARDS, causing coagulopathy, encephalopathy, and even meningitis. So that pneumonia, it causes each and every problem and complications. So paradigmic effusions are because empyema. If you're not treating properly or inadequate treatment in 60% of the patients, we may lead to ARDS around 30 to 40% of the patients. If leading to necrotizing pneumonia or lung abscess cavitations, leading to abscess formations and causing an secondary bacterial infections in the terms of mycobacterium tuberculosis, maybe nocardia or aspergillus also. The reason is important of doing a bronchoscopy or doing a biopsy from the lung and collect the sample and see. Because we see in the necrotizing pneumonia, everything. We see in tuberculosis, we see in nocardia, we see in aspergillosis, we see about the fungal infections and patient about gram-positive infections also. Because of the pneumonia, we see patient developed various cardiac arrhythmias, cardiac infarction, decompensated heart failure, even the cardiac arrest also. Now, the moving in the further about the respiratory, think about the status asthmaticus, treatment of the exacerbations of ventilatory failure in cases of the asthma. We try to do, most of the people want to get muscle relaxants. Muscle relaxants is not the treatment in cases of status asthmaticus. It is main important about beta arginic agonist, corticosteroids, but preferably the inhalation than the IV. Try to understand that even if you IV steroids, actions will start after 3 to 4 hours. Peak action will come after 4 to 6 hours. So that important is about giving the beta arginic agonist or inhaled steroid, not the systemic. We can give anticholinergic agents available now. We can give magnesium in the form of nebulization and IV. The recent gold lines are there. We are not using an aminophylline a lot because of the various common issues and problems, and leukotriene antagonist. If not better, we can use a ketamine. We can use a magnesium sulfate infusion, nebulized, other medications are there, we can utilize for the patient for status asthmaticus. Now, if he's not there, then we try to put the patient on NIV, try to understand this patient requires a BiPAP support, a CPAP support, you have to understand. Because this is not the ideal medication, ideal therapy of choice, because the problem of the proximal airway. If the problem of the proximal airway is there for the patient, the CPAP is not going to work. That in the same way, if the problem with the distal airway is there, the probably NI will going to work for the patient. Okay, so that initial start with the settings of 10 and 5 and try it depending upon the how much the tidal volume patient is generating. If we cannot go on for the patient on the NIV only, if required intubation, he has to do it. As I told, patient having an impending respiratory arrest, a cardiac arrest, patient having tachypnea, tachycardia, patient becoming lethargic, or the patient having silent chest, or patient having barotrauma or undergoing acidosis, all are indications for putting the patient on ventilator for the patient. Or doing an ABG, patient having a severe hypoxia, the patient having an acidosis, the pH is going less than 7.2 with the abnormal pH, not compensation is an indication for starting and ventilator support. The next most common thing we see about the acute exacerbation of COPD or COAD. Even that we do an ABG, see the patient having type 2 respiratory failure, always keep a target saturation of 88 to 92% for the patient. Or if the patient having a chronic type 2 respiratory failure is there, target saturations are 80 to 92 that you have to keep in the mind. Don't behind, because oxygen also be treated like a drug and IV fluids also should be treated like a drug, so that both has to be used judiciously. To assess the sensorium, work of breathing and worsening of hypoxemia or hypercapnia for the patient, then on that basis, we can decide if the patients are saturations are maintained, work of breathing is better, we can observe. If the work of breathing is more, then patient requiring an NIV, give a trial of NIV, if not showing some signs of improvement is there, still patient is worsening, then we can go for the invasive mechanical ventilation for the patient. Okay, so that this is given for the acute exacerbation of COPD treatment. People think that for asthma and COPD treatment is same. It is not true. The treatment is different. We can see here, we give different medications. Most of the times, the main difference is there in cases of asthma and COPD. Exacerbation of COPD is mostly because of the infectious agent. So that role of antibiotics is much more better in cases of COPD, not in cases of asthma. Asthma, the trigger factor is mostly because of the allergens, so that the treatment part, the respiratory treatment, everything will be different in cases of asthma and COPD. Failure of NIV, as I told, because of life-threatening hypoxemia, patient work of breathing is more, patient becoming drowsy, the pH, the ABG is worsening over a period of 2 hours, patient having severe acidosis is a failure of NIV, and the patient requires an invasive ventilation. Now, the other common thing about seeing about the pulmonary embolism, as I told, for the patient, two things you have to keep in the mind. High degree of suspicion is important. Hemodynamic instability. Don't hesitate for thrombolysis. We can thrombolysis do the for the patient. Okay. The drug of choice is alteplase. Some of the people are using alteplase because of the more of the people have a background for the intensive care background. Use the drug of choice is alteplase. And if the patient has cardiac, we use alteplase, a tissue plasminogen activator for the cerebral venous thrombosis. Acute CVA the patient having and the PTE. If human instability is important for thrombolysis, and immediately we start the treatment for the patient by calculating the various scores. The other common things is not having much experience about the people working in the intensive care unit or the operation theater about the endocrine emergencies. When the patient are there, every time you are giving the fluids, vasopressors is not true. If the patient having adrenal emergencies, either because of adrenaline crisis or pheochromocytoma, I'll speak a word about that, because I think more than 1 hour is over for discussion. A patient having thyroid storm or myxedema coma, or patient having hypoglycemia or diabetic ketoacidosis for the patient. Now, what we talk about the acute adrenal crisis, the caveats when to suspect, because I'm not going to the too much details because it become too much for you. Patient having sudden hypotension in response to a procedure or a stress and does not correct with the initial IV fluids or raising legs, then think about whether the patient having adrenal crisis. That time we send for cortisol level and everything is there. It will be difficult to get if you are not used to it. And most of the things, places, these things is not available. So to obviously think about patient having adrenaline crisis, how we know if patient having electrolytes, patient having hypernatremia and patient having a hypokalemia in the ABG, think about patient having adrenal crisis and treatment is about the glucocorticoids. Are patient previously taking a steroid and during the surgery you are not given additional supplementation, think about the adrenal crisis, or patient having mineralocorticoid deficiencies there. So the treatment is there about giving an oxygenation for the patient, do an aggressive fluid electrolyte replacement for the patient, and correction of the potassium, IV hydrocortisone, better to give the bolus of 100 to 200 mg, followed by, because in adrenal crisis, not to give it every 6th hourly, try to get infusion 8 to 10 mg per hour about hydrocortisone for the patient. Okay, and by doing a cortisone acetate test is there, and you can ask depending upon the mineralocorticoids by getting in the levels of ACTH and cortisone level if at US set is available. If not available, we can refer to the other center where the things are done for the patients. But we can, in cases of emergency, we can tide over the emergency and we make the patient stabilized. Now, the other thing about pheochromocytoma, a lot of people has not seen the cases, but the high clinical degree of suspicion is important, is a tumor of the chromaffin cells. Chromaffin cells produce tumor and secrete catecholamines, so that we see the sympathetic response, tachycardia, tachypnea for the patient. Clinical features of those of the tumors are due to excessive catecholamine release, that is due to the direct tissue extension effects of the tumor, and it is one of the cause about 0.1% cases of hypertension, but represent a curable cause of hypertension. The reason any young patient coming with hypertension, we try to rule out the treatable causes of hypertension, so that every young patient don't start an antihypertensive medication. Treat the whether the patient having an the renal cause, the patient having and the pheochromoadrenal cause, or patient having and hypertriglyceridemia, or the patient having and other things are there, then think about and treat. Patient may not require antihypertensive medications in the future also. If the patient having an screening, how to screen the patient for pheochromocytoma, patient having hypertension with a grade 3 to 4 changes of retinopathy with uncertain cause, patient loss of weight, patient having hyperglycemia, patient having hypermetabolism with a normal thyroid profile, patient having cardiomyopathy, and patient requiring more than 2-3 medications for controlling the blood pressure, patient having an orthostatic hypotension, an explained fever, and marked lability of the BP. If these things are there, think high degree of suspicion for pheochromocytoma and do the work for the pheochromocytoma for the patient. This is the most commonly we see in the perioperative period, and think about that and do the workup accordingly. Don't treat every time by giving benzodiazepines and make the patient to sleep. The patient is very anxious. That is not true. The thyroid storm, because this is also the least common people have the experience about the thyroid storm. If you are not able to identify, we have high chances of morbidity and mortality for the patients. Most commonly, thyroid storm, the most of the infection agent basically because of the pneumonia, patient having a heart failure, PTE, diabetic ketoacidosis, because of surgery stress, because of the trauma, hydrogenated contrast agents, withdrawal of the antithyroid drugs, all are responsible for causing a thyroid storm. The treatment because it causes an hyperthermia. Rapid cooling for the patient is very important. Putting in ice packs or cooling blankets for the patient. What we follow up by putting in ice packs in the axilla, in the inguinal regions, or we can give a cold saline, ice cold saline through the feeding tube, urinary catheter, or spray the body with the water and put a fan using a convection and conduction methods for evaporation for reducing the rapid body temperature. That is the common thing we follow in the intensive care unit. If the temperature is more than 101, 102, in spite of giving paracetamol or other things for the patient, the basic treatment about cold sponging is very important for the patient. IV fluids we give depending upon the patient's dehydrated. We need a vasopressors. If the patient having congestive heart failure, we use another medications for them. If you're having a labetalol, we can use 20 to 40 mg as and when required. Calcium channel blockers for the rate control of atrial fibrillation diuretics. And what are the precipitating causes? Try to find out and treat for the patient. The index edema coma, that is the other extremes about the thyroid, thyroid storm and mixed edema coma, typical presentation will be there. This also, whenever you are seeing an electrolytes patient having an unexplained hyponatremia, think about patient having a hypothyroidism. That is one of the clue what you follow in the intensive care unit. If the patient having an unexplained hyponatremia, in spite of doing all things, think about patient having a thyroid problem and try to work up, be able to find out and try to correct. No point in giving 3% NaCl and the various medications for the patient. Most of the things we see about patient having hypothermia, more than 80% of the cases. If the temperature normal, consider there may be infection present. The most common thing we see about the hemodynamic instability, the bradycardia, hyperventilation, respiratory failure, patient having ileus, and patient having a depressed mental status, or maybe in the coma also. Important to mention about the ABC is important. We check about the sugars. If required, give and the replacement of the sugar. If required, SOS about naloxone for the patient. This patient will give hydrocortisone around 100 mg IV start for the patient. And the slow rewarming is very important for the patient by keeping in the scalp, the groin, axilla warm packs, and even the nasogastric lavage. We give thyroxine is available, a T4 IV, 50 microgram IV, or add 25 microgram thyroidine by oral we can give. Is important for the peripheral version, possibly impaired in cases of the mixed edema coma. Careful IV rehydration. If you're giving more, chances of getting at congestive heart failure, and if followed TSH level, should decrease in 24 hours and may normalize within 7 days of the treatment for the patient. I think we should stop here. I can speak. I think glucose metabolism, one of the common emergencies. Should I proceed or should we wait here?
Please proceed, sir. Please proceed.
Okay. Other common problems we monitor and see in the perioperative period about the hyperglycemia or hypoglycemia, we get a lot of confusion what to treat, what not to treat. So that my sincere advice is there. Learn about the basics of the diabetes. The important thing in the perioperative period for the patient to start an insulin. If the patient is going to start within 6 hours the feeding for the patient, we can start an OHS. But anything duration more than 6 to 12 hours is there for the patient, we don't have the control on OHS for the patients because now various new medications came better to follow the insulin. Now the sliding scale is out of vogue. No longer sliding scale is used. Sliding scale is outdated for the last one decade or so. Don't use sliding scale. They found out with the more problems and complications with the sliding scale. So that we follow the basal bolus therapy. Think about in the mind about the basal insulin. We give the long acting insulin, insulin glargine 300, and short acting insulin we use in human ectopic insulin. Intensive care unit we use the long acting insulin degludec and ultra short acting insulin FIAS. If you have the knowledge about insulin, everything we can explore is very easy to understand about things. About the insulin, how much we give the insulin for the patients, we calculate the 6 hours dose of insulin. You see how much required, multiplied by 4. Whatever the 2/3 comes, use a long-acting insulin. Suppose we require insulin around 24 units is there for the patient or 30 units is there for the patient. About 2/3, about we are giving insulin around more than around 18 to 20 units. For the patient, the insulin we give basal, and then we multiply it by 6 into 3 times or 4 into 3 times of the insulin will give you the basal bolus therapy. That's how we calculate the insulin for the basal and bolus therapy, plus or minus 2 units. I think this is the basic idea we should have about the insulin because every time we cannot call the physicians or endocrinologists for referral that we should be able to manage. Because my understanding and my thought process, what I have been training from the central institutes, because diabetes is not a problem related to the physician and endocrinologist. because sugar problem will come everywhere. And sugar is the molecule extensively researched in the medicine and found that if you have the control of the sugar, it's a grade one recommendation in a perioperative period, irrespective of the specialty, whether neurology, cardiology, critical care, the trauma, burns, pregnancy, sugar control is at most important. So that each and every person who's having knowledge of medicine should know to how to monitor the sugar and how to control the sugar. So that going behind the physicians for the sugar and insulin, you should be able to manage the insulin. That's what I want to give the message from this platform. Now, the most common issue about the hypoglycemia, diabetic ketoacidosis, diabetic with unstable blood glucose, alcoholic ketoacidosis, and hyperosmolar hyperglycemic non-ketotic syndrome. Now, I will not go into the details about things. I'll just give the gist about the things. If the hyperglycemic states, particularly the diabetes mellitus, uncontrolled diabetic state itself, hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state, triple H state, the things are different, impaired glucose tolerance and stress hyperglycemia, all things are different for the patient. The baseline is there, even if the patient is non-diabetic, anytime sugar monitoring is more than 180, sugar has to be controlled, whether you are giving insulin or not insulin, there is no confusion about the patient. It's a grade one recommendation is there. Maybe because of stress hyperglycemia, duration will be different. So that the baseline, you have to understand any sugars more than 180 at any moment of time has to be controlled, whatever the permutation combinations we do. Metabolic acidosis states like lactic acidosis, hyperchloremic acidosis, uremic acidosis, drug-induced acidosis. In these cases, unless and until it underlying the thing, how much you give insulin, this all causes insulin resistance, blood sugar is not going to get controlled. And a lot of people have the misconception about when you do dialysis, lactic acidosis get controlled. Lactates are not cleared by dialysis. Okay, so that lactic acidosis is not cleared by the dialysis, you have to understand. Ketotic states, ketotic hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia. So there is overlapping about hyperglycemia, acidosis and ketosis, and diabetic ketoacidosis is there for the patient. Now, you should know the difference between the DKA and HHS. Okay, it's very important because treatment is different. The glucose levels usually more than 300 to 400 for the HHS as compared to the DKA for the patient. The arterial pH will be there in cases of severe, but in HHS, the arterial pH will be maintained. But in cases of diabetic ketoacidosis, pH will be an acidotic. And don't jump on the dialysis for the diabetic ketoacidosis. We are doing a gross mistake or unpardonable mistake. We are doing a dialysis for diabetic ketoacidosis, even a pH of 7. We do the treatment without dialysis, even pH of 6.8, 6.9, we manage the patient unless until life-threatening event for the patient. Now, the main difference of diabetic ketoacidosis, bicarbonate will be always less than 16 to 18 in cases of the diabetic ketoacidosis, and bicarbonates will be always more than 16 or 18 in cases of HHS. The ketones will be positive in cases of diabetic ketoacidosis, HHS ketones will be negative. Osmolarity will be always high, more than 300. Osmolarity will be variable. Anion gap, as I know about anion gap metabolic HGMA, anion metabolic acidosis will decay, and HHS will be not there. So that try to understand HHS and diabetic ketoacidosis are both the different entities are there. Don't jump on for giving an insulin for the patient. Okay, I think it's clear about the things. Management, replicate the fluid losses, replace the electrolyte losses, restore the acid-base balance, replace the deficient insulin, monitor the blood glucose closely, replace the energy losses, seek the underlying cause and treat it, advise it how to avoid the recurrence. Okay, it's very important things are there for the patient. I'm not going to the details because everybody's expert, just we have the broad ideas how to manage this patient is important. Food therapy, an average food deficit in cases of diabetic ketoacidosis at more than 6 to 8 liters. So that you require the fluid for the patient. Initially, give 2 liters of normal saline. Normal saline is no longer normal saline. It became an abnormal saline. If required more than 2 liters is there, change the fluid. Okay, correction of deficit should be taken and over a period of time, we change and fluids of initial 2 to 3 liters of normal saline based on the correction of the sodium. And then prepare the solution, which is having less sodium and less chloride for the patient. The patient should receive a continuous IV insulin infusion for the patient whenever the sugars are more than 180. If the sugars are falling less than 180, add 5% dextrose or 50 to 100 per hour and continue insulin almost for a period of 48 to 72 hours for the patient. Okay. The two alternative low dose regimen are recommended for the current guidelines about continuous IV insulin infusion for the patient, and target sugar should be fall around 70 to 150 milligram per deciliter per hour. If he is falling more rapidly, chances of getting severe edema is there for the patient. IV bolus, unless and until in emergency, don't give an IV bolus, is not a standard of practice. A lot of people want to give an IV bolus and control the rapid control of the sugar. think anything rapid control of should not be done. Whether it is a blood pressure, whether it is a blood sugar, whether the patient having a convulsive therapy, ICP, should be done in a gradual manner. If you are doing very rapidly for the patient, they have the reflex phenomenon, will have much more rebound phenomenon, causing a much more complications problem for the patients. Potassium, this is the most common cause is there for the potassium hypokalemia for the patient. We see in the perioperative period is important about the correction of the potassium. Remember, for 1 milliequivalent of potassium, almost you have to give 150 milliequivalent of potassium, then only 1 liter of potassium can get corrected. You think that we give 40 milligrams of potassium, potassium is not going to correct it. Next, they also have the problem. So keep in the mind, you require almost more than 100 to 150 milligrams of potassium. You give IV and oral both combinations, then only the potassium is going to get corrected. The phosphate, I think it will be difficult for you to understand, but important to keep in the mind, if patient having a hypokalemia is there, one of the not getting corrected, think about the hypophosphatemia or hypocalcemia. IV phosphates are available. No longer you are using the patients of using that enema to give enterally, it causing problems. Hypoglycemia is important not every time not to give and the dextrose and understand people will tell my sugar has fallen and got a hypoglycemia. When unless under sugar fallen less than 70 is not called as a hypoglycemia. When the sugars is falling less than 42 is called as severe hypoglycemia. Most of the people say my sugars are falling, I'm getting all things are there. That is not true. The other causes for hypoglycemia is because of the delayed or missed meals, maybe worsening of the underlying renal disease, worsening of the underlying liver disease, worsening of the underlying sepsis, adrenal insufficiency, maybe many drugs of beta blockers or the fluoroquinolones, our patient having insulinoma, all the reasons are there for causing a hypoglycemia. I think signs and symptoms if the patient having autonomic signs and symptoms are different, neuroglycopenic signs and symptoms are different. It's important, neuroglycopenia is very important to understand. If the patient are getting a neuroglycopenia, it means patient having severe hypoglycemia and patient may have permanent neurological damage. Maybe in the form of seizures, coma, cortical blindness, hypothermia. Here the things will be there, patient having fatigue, dizziness, headache, confusion, visual changes, as compared to the autonomic changes of hunger, sweating, anxiety, paresthesias, palpitation, tremors are different. Okay, I kept particularly this slide blank for all the people to fill up the take home messages, what we discussed for last more than 1.5 hours and so, so that we can fill up the this slide so that we'll understand this much of the what we take from the efforts for last 1 week and so is for able to give the message or clarify the doubts or not. Thank you. Over to you, Sachin and Shushrut.
Good evening and very much elaborative speech and you are at par as from UG also. And I'm very much glad about that. I invited you on this forum and very much happy that you shared a lot of your experience and your as a teacher, your knowledge with us.
Thank you, Sachin. Mainly, as you told me about a lot of things. For the people to do the day-to-day practice, what is there?
Yes. Main motto was mine was, we are at periphery and we are working in ICUs as an anesthesiologist. There is so much inferiority complex with physicians and they don't know our calibration. And so from that point of view, I told that this topic is good for all of us.
We should not have at all. I think that days are gone now. See, we have been trained. The reason, I think, can somebody put the full screen?
Yes. Depend.
And Madhusudan has covered everything in the short time frame.
Yes, Dipen. Mr. Dipen, please put on full screen.
The days are gone for physicians, endocrinologists, cardiologists, everything is due. We are capable, have the knowledge, get updated is very important. Because when you have learned all these things, half of the things I have not learned. When I finished my critical care, ultrasound was not there. After that, I upgraded for last 1 decade and so. Because we have been taught that air is a poor conductor of ultrasound, so that ultrasound is not there. Now, ultrasound became like a stethoscope in the ICU. We are doing ultrasound, we are doing echoes, we are doing transcranial doctors, we are doing the ultrasound of the abdomen. No longer the need for the radiologist, no longer the need for the cardiologist, all things are there. Even for the thrombolysis also, we are doing. Only the things that are there, keep the patient in the loop, and we should do all things. And is there getting updated, what are the guidelines are there and knowledge. There's no point in fighting with the verbally, fight with the knowledge. That is more important.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And that infertility complex, take it from the mind. Nothing is there infertility complex. Everybody is knows the things, and appropriately that time to utilize is very important. The reason what we tell all the people there, day-to-day practice on the bedside rounds, what we do, we should talk. Unless until you talk, discusses, express your doubts, everything is there, will not learn. It's very important. That's what we tell all our people, colleagues, students for last 15, 18 years is there now for in this job. We treated hundreds of students, start hundreds of students, and everything is there. We keep in mind, always be a student, try to learn new things also. Because you know, in the COVID, Hyderabad was the hub for the lung transplant, and people came from all over the India and even the outside world for the lung transplant here. Important, update your knowledge is important. Take out time every 3 months or 6 months, attend the CMEs or the conferences, meetings is very important. And like these forums are there, always talk, discuss. No harm for talking and discussing at all.
Yes. vote of thanks from Dr. Susud, sir. He will give vote of thanks on this evening. Please, sir. Susud, sir. Sir, it's our platinum jubilee year, and this one is a silver jubilee year also of our city branch. So I am conducting this case meets every week.
Congratulations, Sachin. We are doing good work. All the best. Any request from our side, we are always there. We have a conference.
Yes,
conference,
sir.
Is there. We are conducting the month of November.
Okay, sir.
Share the brochure also. That will be very useful. Actually, this is a unique concept is the protocol, not to follow the traditional things. That is the main concept of that conference. Criticize, the name,
sir.
Itself is a, that's kind of, I'll share the brochure to you. We can
yes, sir,
register.
Conference. We'll share. We'll share and register also in this event. I'm really glad that in this weekend evening you joined with us, and very much informative session has happened today, and I'm really glad, sir. I'm really thankful to you. You gave
thanks for inviting me.
Really, you gave a valuable time from your busy schedule, and one of the best session till now happened.
What I told me last time, because tomorrow I have guest lecture at Vizag. There I'm talking about nutrition. The reason I asked, but once you told no, sir, it will be useful, then I had to start this preparation again. Now,
yes,
after
yes.
this, I start nutrition preparation. I thought my
yes, yes.
But you told
a
me
lot of, yes, a lot of members from our team or in my society, in my branch, are conducting or working in ICUs, and they are having their own ICUs. So they need these things, that updated things should be known. And in Corona times, we know that we have to shift patients to Hyderabad. And I know that you are the person who can handle these things very beautifully. So from that point of view, I told all people of ICU from here that you should join, that our mentor is coming on our platform. So I think the Susud sir is
a good learning lesson for me also. When you told me the subject, I started searching what are the common emergencies are there. I think 6 months. Every topic is the daily we conduct the lectures for the students. Then I'm searching
yes,
the topics. How many emergencies are there for the patient? Then I thought initially only include 4 or 5 emergencies. Then you told me very useful. Then I told you it is not a justice. We are not doing justice for the people who come for listening.
Really, really, very much efforts you have taken for this lecture, sir.
If things are okay.
Yes, yes. Really, really informative. And I think I didn't work in nowadays in ICU, but in previously in my learning phases, I did till 2015, I did work in ICUs. And I know what are the difficulties happen and are in the field of ICUs across an anesthetologist who is newcomer for this field. And you cover all topics from that point of view. And really, I appreciate your work and your efforts on this topic.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you. In future, you require anything, we are always there.
Really, really, sir. I will bother to disturb you on the any other topics also. And really appreciate your commitments. And sir, as a you senior, and we are looking forward to you that we are doing something different at our levels, and you are helping in this era. So thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. I will conclude this session with one last thanks a lot session with you. You are the PG teacher, you are the academician, and you are the experienced professional also, and you are giving us this small branch like ISN Andhra Civil Branch conducting these sessions, and you are coming for this session. This is a great thing for me also, and all our MITians are also proud of you that you are doing very, very great work in Hyderabad, sir. Best luck for your future, and thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I laugh now. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Bye bye. Good night.
Thanks. Good night, sir. Good night. Have a good weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I will conclude this session. Thanks. Mm-hmm.